Hey guys, it's JH. Welcome to practice day. Happy New Year and all that. Haven't been able to get out here, guys. The weather's been so bad. We just never have weather like this here. It's just been sort of typical English weather. It just rained every day, and you just never know when it was coming. Anyway, we've got a little bit of respite today, so I thought I'd duck out in between showers. Okay guys, because it's still potential to rain. Okay, carrying on with Yogi Lock. What I wanted to do today was give some intrinsic insight into, there are some very significant nuances in the golf swing. Now, Yogi Lock is a combination of Count Yogi's golf swing, which is the negative positive load, and the channel lock, which is rear foot, back foot, trail foot, ball position, closed shoulders, very much into out with closed shoulders at impact. So it's a combination, and that's why we've called it Yogi Lock, because I think there's so many good things in both the swings, and I thought a combination of them, a grafting of them, a blending of them, would just give us the best of both worlds. So some intrinsics about Yogi Lock. Now the process, someone asked about what is the actual definitive process of setting up with Yogi Lock. Well guys, I always take my grip and my hand stance away from the golf ball like this, and Yogi did it very much. Yogi used to do that, and he'd look down what he called the leading edge of the golf club, and he always saw that leading edge transferring itself to what he called the arrow line of flight, which was his direction of start and where he wanted the ball to go. So he used to come in here like this, have a look at that leading edge, get it square, get the grip, put it down. Now this is Yogi's ball position, it's not Yogi Lock ball position. His was there, he'd come in here, he'd just get, and then he'd just drag it back, guys. He used to say downwards and inwards and upwards. It was downwards, inwards and upwards. Now it was like that. If you had a paintbrush here, guys, and you're going to paint a line along the ground there with a big 6-inch brush, that's the action you want. You want that action, you want that. He used to go negative, positive. That was the advantage of his golf swing. The loading was enormous. Now you've got to do that very leisurely. And he also, with his grip, guys, he got the trail, or the lead thumb, off to the side of the shaft. He didn't have it on top, he had it there. So that when he put the trail hand in, it really did lock that lead thumb onto the grip. He never had it here, he had it there. Now what that does, guys, by having that sort of split there, or that opening of, or that formation of that V there, it gives you a lot of mobility in the wrists for cocking the club and getting that mobility. Lots of that. So that's important, that's the grip. But the standard setup, guys, is basically is once you've taken that grip, and we're going to go to Yogi Lock now, which is trail for, Yogi Lock, which is channel lock ball position. Now with channel lock, it's off the right, the trail foot. So what we do is we look up our arrow line of flight. When we put it down now, I'm putting the club down. See how the lead foot's way back here? I'm putting it down, putting the club down and the ball in line with my trail foot. Now I'll do this slowly. I put it down. I then bring the lead foot up. I then move the trail foot back. Now, as soon as I move that trail foot back that way, I'm only going rearwards, guys. I'm not going outwards. I'm just going from there to there. Now, as soon as I do that, it looked like the ball's moved forward, but it hasn't. And what I want to do is have that process that Yogi had in his golf swing, which is basically setting up here, coming in with the lead foot, bringing the trail foot back, and then getting into motion. So that's basically the setup procedure. Now, the other really intrinsic aspect of Yogi's golf swing and how he generated all his speed, I mean, I'm about 5'11", and he was shorter than me. He was probably about 5'9 or 5'10", and not a big guy, and not muscular or strong or athletic, but he developed probably 135 mile an hour golf club speed. How did he do that? Well, guys, he employed what we call parametric acceleration. And there are some videos that I did, you know, 4 or 5 years ago on my channel, Count Yogi Parametric Acceleration. Just put that into your search engine on One Atomic Golf and it'll come up. But basically what it is, guys, is parametric acceleration is when the club has come down, the lead hand is pulling up. It's pulling up on the handle. It's pulling up on the handle. It's not going forward like that. The trail arm, which folded in the backswing, goes here, it folds in the backswing, essentially just straightens on the downswing, and the lead arm pulls up. I'm sure, I never got a chance, of course, ever to speak to Yogi, and no one else has ever mentioned this aspect, but I'm sure that Yogi, in his mind, wanted the golf club to basically come to a halt there by doing that. Because when he did that, the club went out with tremendous velocity. If you've got a tennis ball on a string, guys, and you wind it like that, and you pull it in here like that, you bring that fulcrum point, that fixed pivot point in here, that orbiting velocity increases enormously. That's what he did in his golf swing. And in the downswing, he never wanted this. He never wanted what we call jam lag. You'll never see Yogi like that. You'll see Yogi like that. Because Yogi wanted the widest arc in the downswing, and he wanted to get the golf club accelerating very early. His golf swing was a flattened circle. It was elliptical, like an oval shape. It wasn't circular, it wasn't V-shaped. It was very wide, and that type of golf swing. Now, I think he basically just straightened that trail arm and then just pulled that lead arm up like that. And that's, when you do that, guys, just in a little swing like that, the velocity that you can feel in the golf club is just huge. Now, that's parametric acceleration. Now, if you've never done that, it'll drive you nuts. But if you just hit a couple of little short shots, get an 8-iron or something, this is a 5-iron, but just get an 8-iron or something, just take it back here, and then go, whoosh, just pull that, bring it almost this to a stop and pull the handle what you think is up here. You won't get a chicken wing, but that's the feeling you want. That's parametric acceleration here. You see a lot of guys on the tour for the last 10 years have all been up on their toes at impact. Bubba and all types of guys, I think Justin Thomas, they get up there, guys, because they're standing up through the ball and they're applying parametric acceleration. Because in the feeling for that, they want to pull the club up. So they can't pull it up much if they don't actually increase their height through the ball. So you see a lot of them doing it. Girls do it, LPGA players. Most LPGA players are up on their toes when they hit it. They've always done that. Not all of them, but a lot of them. So that's parametric acceleration. Now, the other thing that's really important is that with Yogi's grip, or he said he never gripped the club. He just touched it. And I think that's probably a very, very good description of the way he held the golf club. He didn't grip it, he just touched it, just put his hands on it. And he said by his own admission, he didn't have very strong hands at all. If you look at him, it's sort of very sort of, you know, like very feminine type arms and hands, and they're very artistic type, you know, musculature and limb formation. Didn't look like an athlete, but you could hit it like Sam Snead told me. When Yogi wanted to, he could hit it 100 past Sam Snead. He said he could hit it 100 past me. This guy, big. And that was parametric acceleration, guys. So what we've got to try and do in this swing is try and get as much of that. See, he started from here and then he went here. He went here, and then he felt like he wanted to hit up. Every shot was up. And as I explained before, my friend saw him hit off a steel plate that had a little indentation on it. And he was hitting two irons off that plate. He just put it in the indentation and hit the ball off a steel plate. It was only indentation so the ball wouldn't run away. But he could hit a two iron off a steel plate and hit it 150 feet in the air. Hit like that, guys. Just, there it is there. That's what Yogi power was. And I think if we can incorporate that velocity, those mechanics, with channel lock ball position, and we've had tremendous rain here, guys, and the ground is boggy and soggy. Haven't had a hit, haven't been out here for ages. So, yeah. All we want is the flow. Don't be too enamored with trying to hit the ball. Just take it back as much as you can like that. Feel when you get to the top of the swing, it's like that. And then it'll underplane and it'll go from negative to positive. You can't take it back negative and stay negative. You have to go negative, positive. So just a little bunt like here, but this is essentially the action, just negative, positive. That's essentially the action. And if you can hit a few shots like that, with no consideration for putting any effort into the golf swing, just try and load it negatively, and then just fire it away. I still can't get, I want to get that in my golf swing. I want to have my hands go back there and the club head still here, because that will give me huge negative loading, or negative into positive. But the way to feel it is to just try and do that. Negative, positive. Just try and do that, guys. Just try and do that. Just negative to positive. All right, I'll hit a full shot. The old range manager, Frankie, the old range manager's just turned up, the old tank commander. Okay, so I'll hit a full shot, and there's a bit of rain coming in, guys, so I won't be able to do too much in terms of time. Thanks, Frankie. Yeah, that's good in the shade there. He just brought me a refreshment. Okay, guys, so this is what I think is Yogi power and channel lock geometry structure. And so this is what we call Yogi lock. So here we go, guys. Here we are here. We come in here, put the club down, move here back. You just fold that trail arm and you just straighten that trail arm and pull that lead arm up. It's here. Right, and I'll do that a bit smoother. Here. Now, guys, they're just little sort of what I call, three-quarter little bunts. Just trying to get the loading. Well, I'm warmed up now, so we'll hit a full one. So here we go. We come in here. Now, the other thing, guys, is so important with Yogi Lock is you've got to get on with it. Don't get in here and then think about it. Get in here and get going. And that was Yogi's infallible mental routine. He never stopped. He was millisecond precise all the time. So here we go. This is it. Come in here. Now, guys, see how it gets the body through? As I say, this is an 80-year-old body this year. But see how it pulls me through? I'm not trying to do anything. It's just pulling me through. I'm not trying to do anything. Just the velocity of this is pulling me through. Now, Yogi used to finish like this. Chest open. Okay, come on, James. Here. Now, I very much feel the club going straight up there, guys. And I do feel that lead arm coming back towards me. Now, in terms of parametric acceleration, I reckon even when I was fooling around with Yogi 5 or 6 years ago, I was only getting 40-50% of what I really needed to get. And then I went away from it and was doing other stuff. But if I can improve the parametric acceleration component, well, here we go. Come on, Jason. Now this is Yogi. It's here. Comes in, sees where he wants to go, puts it down. Can't hit it better than that. Cannot hit the ball better than that. And if you look back to, I don't know, a couple of the Yogi videos on One Atomic Golf back, you know, 5 or 6 years ago, you'll see a very similar action to that. That type of flow. Now we've got a brutal crosshead wind in here, left to right, but that ball's not moving. Okay, come on. Aiming at a tree up there, and it's just right at the base of the tree. And it's like a, you know, 2.5 club wind. It's just so brutal. So that's the flow, guy. That's the flow that we want. Okay, come on. Okay, now do a good job. Take the club here. Look up there. Look at the target. Here. Put it in there. Left foot, right. What's the ball flight like? Incredibly high, but amazingly boring. And you would have this type of flight, guys. You have that flight, zoom. No parabolics in it, there's none of that. So it'll go out to a zenith, run out of its ballistic flight and just fall straight down. So what you've got there is you've got the height and carry, plus you've got the stopping power. And with an iron, guys, to hitting to a target, you don't want to run the ball. You want to have stopping power. All right, now I'll see if I can get it back a bit further. Here we go. All I want to do is fold that right arm and then straighten it and pull the left arm in. Here. Straighten that right arm. Whoa. Perfect. I just got to give myself more time in the backswing for transition. You got to get it back and feel that change of direction. That's what you got to do. Like that. Wow. You could just feel, you know, the heat in that shot when you hit it. It comes off the club so hot. Well, not out of control hot, just speed hot. I love practicing in this wind because it's the hardest wind you'll ever practice in. That ball's not moving. Now, the other, because the ball's back here, guys, we want closed shoulders and very much into out as our attack path. So the ball just starts right off target. It just has that little imperceptible draw on it. Really windy. Come on. Guys, that takes me back 40 years. Oh, wow. That amount of mobility, wow. I mean, that is just off the scale, satisfying. Off the scale satisfying. And we're out of wet grass here, guys. I never wear spikes when I practice. I do that deliberately because it makes me get some ground effects, some pushing down. All right, come on. So just fold that right arm and then just straighten it. So the good thing is, guys, you don't miss hit the ball. And you can hit off the tightest of lies. Your tight lies don't worry you. You just basically, the club is always at ball level. All the time. Come on, Jay. That takes me back to first year I started playing golf. Now, guys, see how I get on with it so quickly? And did Yogi. Yogi was millisecond precise in addressing the ball and getting going. Mo Norman was the same. Okay, come on. Come on now, really try and negative load it going back. Get a big paintbrush. Just fold that right arm, straighten that right arm. Like that. Now, what's interesting there, because I applied so much hit on that, these shafts are very light and graphite, and it just felt like the shaft was going to break. And of course, it doesn't have the torque of a steel shaft. And I only use these guys because I hit so many balls that if I use steel, it just tends to blow my elbows and wrists out because I hit millions of golf balls. But that power there, if I was going to use Yogi lock all the time, I would just have to have stronger shafts. Because that actually comes in, bows it forward and kicks down, so you get a real hard power draw. And I don't like that. It just shuts the face down a little bit. I'd rather just have a little soft draw. Some guys might like that. But there was a lot of power in that. That's carried like 15 over the other one. Okay, come on. Here. And guys, that's in exactly the same. That's on top of the other golf ball. Now, it's no different, guys. The great thing about this golf swing is that it's exactly the same for everything. Now, the thing that will be difficult for a lot of people with this golf swing is the driver. Playing the driver, if you want to use Yogi lock, if you want to use Yogi, you can just play it up the front. But if you want to use Yogi lock and the benefits of Yogi lock and channel lock's ball position, we're playing the ball from here, guys, as opposed to here. So there's sort of 18 inches difference in the ball position. But the swing's the same. Swing's exactly the same. Doesn't feel any different, not at all. Not at all. Come on, just load it a little bit more. Load it a bit more. Those hits are just absolute dead center of the golf club. Now, because the club is longer, you've got to get it going earlier. And that's why you really need to straighten that right arm or trail arm as early as you can. Same golf swing, guys. It is the same golf swing. Now I can feel that. I can feel that club coming in here. And this is a really hard driver to hit. It's only about, it's supposed to be 8.5, but it's under 8 degrees. So it's a very low spin. So it's not an easy driver to hit, but that ball flight right there is just, considering we've got, 30K left to right headwind, it's just perfect flight. Okay, last shot. Last shot. Come on. Big Yogi lock driver. You don't want to stop when you're hitting good. Okay, I'll really try and straighten that right arm. Trail arm. okay, guys, they're all the same. If I get a chance, I'll come back and just do a little explanation on chipping the ball and pitching the ball. Because somebody's asked about that. So, guys, we'll do more as the weeks go on. It's just hard getting back at the moment to get into the swing of things. But if I get any time, I'll just do a little video on some chipping and pitching. Chipping's tough with Yogi Lock, because you know what Yogi did, all that movement of the head, you've got to have impeccable timing and quietness of body. But you can do it. Pitching's easy. Guys, if I get a chance and come back, and we might hit a few shots downrange if I get a chance. Okay, guys, but if not, we'll probably do some tomorrow or the next day if the weather's good. But this can be the first quarter of the year, we'll call it the Yogi Lock first quarter.